Thank you for the opportunity to be here. We are going to debate the question, does Christianity harm women? The other question before us this evening is there a problem with women in the new atheist movement? My name is Karen Garst. You may find me at www.faithlessfeminist.com. I am taking the affirmative position. First, I'd like to talk a little bit about what is feminism. There are three waves of feminism, according to cultural scholars. The first involves the right to vote, and that came out of the abolition movement and developed into the women's rights movement and secured the right to vote in 1920. These are the times of Sojourner Truth, Ain't I a Woman's speech. Imagine Susan B. Anthony slammed to the sidewalk by the police. They worked for decades to secure women the right to vote, and that's considered the first wave. The second wave occurred in the 60s and 80s and is involved with issues like wage parity, when we started to talk about equal pay for equal work among the genders. Also involved in reproductive rights. In 1973, the U.S. Supreme Court issued its decision in Roe v. Wade. And also redefining family roles and the discussion of maternity and then later paternity leave. The people you know from this era are Betty Friedan, Germaine Greer, Gloria Steinem, and Coretta Scott King. The third wave is thought to have started in the 1990s. This blended a lot of issues in addition to issues of gender equality. Race, how did that impact women's rights? Gender identity, how did people who did not identify as heterosexual fit in? Were they transgendered? Were they lesbians? Were they gay? How did that add to the discussion of feminism? And it's often called intersectionality, where all of these things work together. So with that brief introduction to feminism, let's talk about Christianity's impact on women. The first impact of Christianity on women is the elimination of the female divine. As far back as the Paleolithic, we can see figurines predominantly of females, often pregnant, large breasts, etc., where there was some veneration of the female. This is the person who gave birth. This helped the tribe continue. And then later on, we have Greek mythology, where we have a very strong goddess in Demeter, the grain goddess, who had power in her own right. When monotheism came along, this was an abrupt break with having a female divine, and it eliminated any notion of the feminine. Interestingly enough, as the Hebrews developed monotheism, this was also happening in other cultures. For example, in Babylonia, Marduk made a deal with the other gods, male, that said, hey, if you make me supreme god, I'll kill Tiamat, the female, and we'll be great. And it's interesting that, of course, the Hebrews, when they were exiled in Babylon, 586 BCE, they heard about this myth. That has had an impact on women ever since. Second, a very early focus on sex and sin. And I will give due credit to this to St. Augustine in the 5th century, who really promulgated the idea of original sin, linking it to lust or concupiscence, as he said, and tracing it back to Eve. So the association of sin with a female, with Eve, has been with us ever since. Third, the Virgin Mary is the model. Obviously, a lot of different myths had a virgin. A lot of different gods were born of a virgin. This was a meme that was going around. But what you see through Christianity is this female, the Virgin Mary, being elevated because of a thirst people had for a female divine. First of all, there's a virgin birth. Next, the concept comes along that the Virgin Mary herself was conceived, immaculate conception, as a without sexual relations. And then finally, the ascension, where she ascends into heaven. So there is some kind of need there that the Catholic Church tries to promote as it elevates the Virgin Mary. Fourth is a very sad story of atrocities. And I will talk particularly about the atrocities against women. Hypatia was a brilliant mathematician and philosopher in the 5th century. The Christians, this was in Alexandria, the Christian mob attacked her and skinned her with clamshells and obviously murdered her, as well as destroying the library in Alexandria. The Crusades killed hundreds of thousands of people, including women and children. And the Malleus Maleficarum was promulgated by the Catholic Church in the 15th century, which basically killed hundreds of thousands of predominantly women who were deemed to be witches. This was the same time the males were trying to enter the medical profession. Oh, and lo and behold, the women are the midwives, the women know the herbal remedies. So, isn't this a good way to eliminate them from this process? And then finally, you may have heard recently of the Madeleine Laundries in Ireland. This was a home for unwed mothers, and what they did was exploit them and have them work for free. They recently found 800 skeletons of babies that were deposited in a septic tank from 1925 to 1961. These babies died, young children died from malnutrition and TB. And we don't have time to continue this history. The legacy of patriarchy continues today. It wasn't until 1900 that all the states allowed women to own property. Pretty hard to catch up when you don't even get the right to own property until 1900. There are a lot of cultural legacies of patriarchy. For example, if you know and you have a daughter and her fiance comes and asks for you as the father, your hand in marriage, that traced back to the fact that the daughters used to be the property of the man and they had to have permission to take that property away from them. So even our cultural memes continue this impact on women. And then finally, the religious attacks on reproduction rights. Today, every single Republican candidate is against, including the only woman candidate, Carly Fiorina, is against Planned Parenthood, which provides birth control. They're against safe abortions. Even the Catholic Church, the Irish priests, are in opposition to the systematic oppression of women within the Catholic Church. And then finally, new atheism's impact on women. I want to give credit to the Four Horsemen, Richard Dawkins, Daniel Dennett, Christopher Hitchens, and Sam Harris. They certainly raised the issue of atheism to a new level. I think one of the reasons that the men are featured more is a focus on science and philosophy, which has been predominantly, up until the last few decades, dominated by men, so it's not surprising. These people are philosophers or scientists. But there are many women's voices that just don't get to be heard. As an example, Christopher Hitchens credited the work of Jennifer Michael Hecht in his book, saying that her work, Doubt, A History, he owed a great debt to her. But have you heard of her? Do you see her? Is her name mentioned? No. Susan Jacoby is another author that is an incredible writer and has done a lot of work but doesn't have the stature that the Four Horsemen do. And then finally, Annie Laurie Gaylor is the co-president of the Freedom From Religion Foundation in Madison, Wisconsin, with her husband Dan Barker, and she often remarks that when somebody asks for a debate, they ask for Dan and not her, yet she has published a great deal in this field. One of the issues I think is neglected is talking about culture and how religion systematically subjugates women through the experience of religion. I am writing a book about 17 women experience in religion and how they were held back, how they were told to submit to their husband's wishes, how they were brainwashed about the world around them. And I think it's those issues that need to be more in the forefront. And I'm very happy to let you know that my book is going to be published probably in the fall or winter of 2016. Finally, I would just like to say that I have a blog at the address I previously said, www.faithlessfeminist.com. Its focus is on women and religion. I accept guest posts, in fact, encourage them. And if you decide to subscribe, all you have to do is leave your email. Nothing will happen to you. You won't get a nasty anything in the mail. I do send out a notice once a week about a new post, so you're notified of that. Thank you again.
Okay, thank you, Karen. So again, can you leave this on the top there? So again, our topic is, does Christianity harm women, and is there a problem with women in the new atheist movement? Karen gave the pro, or the affirmation of that, saying, yes, Christianity does harm women, and yes, there is a problem with women in the new atheist movement, and so I'm going to give a con position to that. My name is Bernie Dehler. I have a booklet that I wrote that's for sale on Amazon. It's called Modern Science and Philosophy Destroy Christian Theology. I'm a former evangelical Christian preacher. I used to preach the gospel on TV, and now I'm preaching atheism. So, and I'm also very active in local Portland area debates on Christianity and atheism, and so on my YouTube channel you can see a whole bunch of those. Okay, so now I'll start. Okay, so on the handout you can see I've got a picture that's kind of funny. It says, women are not decorations, and it shows some other women from Hooters there. And so this is kind of interesting because I'm going to bring this up later, but some women think how you dress is very important and it could be a feminist issue. So this kind of shows maybe, you can see the woman in the tight clothes kind of looking perplexed at the other one with the sign. So this is kind of interesting even among women. So I'm going to bring up some definitions just for clarification here. Okay, so first, what is feminism? So feminism, in my view, I'm just trying to say it's very clear and simple. It's just that women deserve equal rights with men. And some women don't like that word feminism, or some guys, because they think it's radical and it's very pro-women at the expense of hurting guys, and so they think a better word is egalitarianism, which seems that basically means that men and women are equal. But that word could actually mean more of humanity, that, you know, all races and people are equal, so it's more than just men and women. So I think feminism really is a good way to express equal rights for women as a term. It's just that it's got a lot of bad baggage, and so some people don't like to be called a feminist. You can call me a feminist because I fully support equal rights for women. Misogyny is a word to mean that, you know, it's a woman hater. So sometimes, you know, if a guy says, oh, all women are stupid, that's a misogynist statement. And then also some women may hate guys, and that's called misandry. So basically, if a woman says all guys are stupid, that's showing hatred for guys. So just to give an example here, I looked on the internet here, and Augustine was a bishop, a very famous bishop for both Catholics and Protestants. They, you know, for example, he wrote the book, he's noted as one of the church fathers, and wrote The City of God and Confessions. He's very well known with philosophers too. Basically, here's a quote from him. This is a misogyny example. Woman was merely man's helpmate, a function which pertains to her alone. She is not the image of God, but as far as man is concerned, he is by himself the image of God. So very clearly, men and women are not equal there. Woman is merely man's helpmate, and the image of God is on men only, not on women. So how are guys put down by women? Some people have said that, well, if you look at a lot of modern sitcoms, for example, it's very common to make fun of guys, like Homer Simpson, for example, is a stupid, goofy guy. You don't really see sitcoms with stupid women, although Married with Children has kind of a stupid guy and a stupid woman, but mostly it's a stupid guy in there, I think, too. But, you know, like Beavis and Butthead is another example, and somebody else said, everyone loves Ray. Yeah, they love him, but he's kind of a doofus, too, sometimes. And so that may be an example of how men are put down in modern culture. So my next one here, I show a slide of three ways that women can dress. And I want to show this to explain some extremes. On the one hand, you have people saying women should be covered head to toe in a bag. You know, that's the burqa. And then on the other extreme, you might say, hey, women can wear nothing. This, the one on the right, she's wearing body paint. You know, so she's basically naked. And I don't know, she could probably walk around in public and get away with that, I would think. And then in the middle there, you got your gray area. It's like, well, it's just wearing clothes. It's no big deal. So women, or guys even, they could argue about what's the appropriate way to dress. The woman on the right wearing just body paint, somebody could say, that's very demeaning to women. I'm a feminist, and this is appalling to me. Well, I would say this really has nothing to do with feminism. This has to do more with what's socially acceptable. So I think this is one way how feminism could be misconstrued, because it doesn't really apply here. But on the other hand, you know, wearing the bag, you can say this is a feminist issue, because You know, women shouldn't have to be covered in a bag. But, you know, another argument might be, well, what if the woman wants to be covered? Well, maybe she just needs to be liberated in her mind as well, though. She needs to know what equality is, and it's healthier to not be wearing a bag, you know. Because why she want to be in a bag anyway? It's probably because of the religion that has polluted their mind in that thinking. Maybe, you know, because they're taught that guys can't control their lusts and we need to help them by covering up. Okay, so now let's get to the main question. Does Christianity harm women? And so I kind of have a yes and a no on this. So basically, one of my first points is, what is a Christian? I think it's important to say that we need to respect people. If they say they're a Christian, we need to accept that. We can't say, no, you don't believe the right thing, so you're not a Christian. There's the no true Scotsman fallacy where, you know, if you say all true Scotsmen do this, and somebody says, well, here's a Scotsman over here that doesn't do that, and you could say, well, that's not a true Scotsman. So in the same way, I don't think we should be in the position of saying, what's a true Christian? If somebody says a Christian, they're a Christian, that's good enough for me. I'm going to bring that up later to show that not all Christians have a problem with women. Okay, but, you know, for sure, the largest denomination by far is Roman Catholicism. Now, there's more Protestants than Catholics in America, but they're fractured across different denominations. So if you just go by denomination, by far the biggest group is Roman Catholicism. Of course, they've got all kinds of troubles with women. I mean, the top guy's a pope. You're never going to see a woman pope. They have a priest and a nun system, and nuns, you know, women can't be priests, and I think nuns are lower in hierarchy than the priests. So there's obvious problems with that. So there are, and you know, the Catholic Church does not like to change, and so that's not going to be changing anytime soon. So there are obvious issues with feminism in some Christian religions. But the question is it all Christians? Do all Christians have a problem with feminism? So when I was a Christian I was a Christian for many years. I went through many different denominations. My last denomination was what you might call evolutionary creationist, where I totally accepted all of science. And I had no issue with women. I had no problem with women. Now, people in this camp, usually they say, you know, it's all about a relationship with Jesus. You pray to Jesus and you have a relationship with Jesus. And that's the biggest thing. And you can read the Bible for good stuff out of it, and if there's something bad in there, don't let it worry you. You know, someday you go to heaven and that'll get all worked out, but you know, if there's something you don't understand, just don't worry about it. So there are people like that I think totally have no problem with women whatsoever. So because of that, you cannot say that all Christians and all Christian sects, all Christian denominations have a problem with women, I think. But I would certainly agree, maybe most of them do, or the vast majority of them do. Okay, so, and you know, also women, probably Protestants and Catholics have a problem with women in leadership. You know, the head pastor cannot be a woman, for example. But, you know, when you consider the Foursquare Church as an evangelical church, I mean, that was actually started by a woman. So there's no way you can say they would probably have a problem with women equality. I think they have full liberation for women. As far as I know, they don't have any limits on what women can do. And so I would say maybe the more Pentecostal the Christian group is, the more freedom there is on that. So bottom line, I would say, is there a problem with Christianity? Yes. But not all of them. Now, is there a problem for women in the New Atheism movement? I would say there's no problems with women and feminism in the atheist movement whatsoever. But there is a lot of gossip going around. Has anybody heard of Elevator Gate with Rebecca Watson? Are you guys familiar with that? Okay. Just briefly, what happened was Rebecca Watson, she goes by Skeptic. She was in an elevator at 4 in the morning going to her room after a conference, and a guy said, hey, don't take this wrong, but you know, I really like what you said. Would you like to come to my room for coffee? And she said, listen, guys, don't do that. That is, you know, it was very bad and all this. And so then Richard Dawkins said, hey, you know, you think that's abusive or something. You need to get out more. I mean, Muslims are really getting, you know, tortured over this. And here you are, you know, complaining about this. Come on. And so they just went back and forth. And so Dawkins is a really bad guy. And, you know, they just amped it up and left it at that. Another case is, have you guys heard of Michael Shermer's rape dispute. So somebody said he date raped the girl, basically, and this never went to court or anything. So people are talking about this in the gossip arena, and it gets very emotional. So, but the bottom line is, it's all about gossip. If you look at the big picture for feminism, I mean, we can see where it's gotten us. It's, you know, the right to vote for women, the right to education, the right to work, equal pay for equal work, right to birth control, abortion was made safer. So in America, I think, you know, feminism has really gone a lot. So far, maybe it's not really much even an issue now for most Americans, and now we've elevated it to human rights and even animal rights. Okay, so I'll just finish up here. But in summary, I would have to say that there is no problem with anti-feminism. There's no problem with women in the atheist movement because there's nothing in it that says women are inferior and shouldn't be doing things. And in fact, I think they're actually probably actively reaching out for women in conferences and things like that. So that's my position. So now we'll have some interchange, about 5 minutes for me to question you, and then 5 minutes for you to question me. Okay, so I'll put 5 minutes on the timer here, and then we're going to have audience Q&A and discussion, just general discussion. Okay, so 5 minutes. Karen, you mentioned a lot about the history. So just to clarify, does Christianity harm women? Is your position that, yes, all Christians and all Christian theologies and all Christian denominations are harmful to women? That's your position?
Well, I think you made a really good point that if somebody says, I'm a Christian, we should accept that. However, I was talking about the doctrine of Christianity. So I think we have to clarify not how somebody identifies themselves, but what is the doctrine? What is the book, the Bible? Do they accept the Bible? One of the biggest problems, I think, in terms of Christianity is the notion of child sacrifice.
Well, now, okay, so since I'm asking you the questions, I'll have the power to interrupt, and then when I ask...
Oh, interrupt?
Yeah, okay, and then when you're asking questions, you can interrupt me when I try to give them. Okay, because I want to make sure that you're getting my question. The Four Square Church, for example, do you think the Four Square Church has a problem with women?
I think if they preach Christianity and the gospel,
which they do, yes.
I think that's a problem. Because I think the basis of Christianity...
Well, so what specifically do you think they would say that is a problem for feminism?
Well, I think the whole notion that there's a male God who decided to sacrifice his child is an Iron Age barbaric concept that... I would hope that most women would say, I would never sacrifice my child. That's a barbaric, we find skeletons in Mayan temples, but it's not something I would do. And it's an Iron Age concept that has been in Christianity about sacrificing a child and atonement. And I think it's a barbarous concept.
Okay, so I see that you don't like that concept, but... What if we said feminism is all about equality, equal rights? Do you see any rights being violated for women in the church? Do you see women being held back in any way whatsoever in the Four Square Church, for example?
Okay, I'm not at all familiar with the Four Square Church, so I can't respond to that. Most Christian churches, I, for example, quite recently, maybe the last 20 years, when our son was young, attended a Lutheran church in Tualatin. A woman could not be a pastor, right. And a woman couldn't even serve on the council.
Okay, I already agree with you on that stuff.
Okay.
So I'm trying to go into some other territory where maybe we have a disagreement. So in the Four Square Church, if a woman can do everything a man can do as far as teach and preach, and like mm-hmm. I said, it was even founded by a woman. I think it was Amy Semple McPherson, I think. Anyway, so it was even founded by a woman. If the woman can do everything that a man could do, then wouldn't you say there's not a problem with feminism there? As long as
there's a problem if what they're talking about is misogynistic. Yes, it's still a problem.
But
if what they're preaching is the Bible, that's a problem.
But isn't feminism about a movement of giving women equal rights with men? And so if they have equal rights, then the job is done. Is that inaccurate to say?
Might be a hard one to tackle, but I think that if the woman has a right to a job to be a pastor of that church, that's a good thing if that's what she wants to do. What I'm saying is what she is preaching is against women and harms women because it's a patriarchal religion created by men to control people. So as a feminist and wanting equal rights, I wouldn't want to hear that from a man or a woman.
But it seems like it has their beliefs have no practical effect if the result is that the women are fully empowered like all the guys in the church. If the women can do everything the guy can do, whatever objection you have to their theology seems like it doesn't really have a practical effect because they're doing everything.
Well, then you're talking about the right to have a job versus a doctrine of Christianity. And I really think the question was, does Christianity itself harm women, okay, not can women have the jobs as pastors? That, okay, to me, isn't the big issue.
So right there, though, again, you're saying you're saying the beliefs of Christianity as if there's one beliefs of Christianity, whereas the Foursquare Christianity is much different than the Catholic Christianity. So there is no, that's why I said at the very start, we need to honor people. If they say they're Christians, then we have to accept them as Christians and not say you don't have the right Christianity because you don't believe the Bible literally, for example.
Okay. However,
I'll let you finish because we're out of time on this one.
If somebody says, I'm a Christian and I don't believe in God and I don't believe in the resurrection of Jesus, okay, but I don't think you're going that far. So you've got to look at the teachings, what they're talking about when they say they're a Christian. So anything other than, I'm a Christian, I don't believe in God, I don't believe in child sacrifice, I don't believe in the resurrection. Other than that, I think what they're preaching is harmful to women because the Bible subjugates women.
Okay, so that's timed up. So now it's 5 minutes for you to challenge me. What did I say that you disagree with?
I'd like to talk a little bit about Rebecca Watson. Mm-hmm. And have you heard of Thunderfoot?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I've been listening to him. I got his
story.
What
do you think of Thunderfoot's video on feminism poisons everything?
Okay, so what specifically did he say that you didn't like?
Well, he doesn't believe in feminism. Certainly not as you defined it.
Well, so again, you need to be specific. What specifically did he say about feminism? Because, I mean, Thunderfoot, I think, again, Like if a woman says, oh, a woman shouldn't dress like that, I'm a feminist and I believe this, that doesn't mean it's a feminist issue. It's sometimes they're confusing. Just because a feminist says something doesn't mean it's a feminist issue. And I think Thunderfoot got confused on that. So he's after, like, Rebecca Watson or something and saying, look at this feminist saying this. And, but that's not about feminism. That's just about personal beliefs and social things.
Yeah, let's explain who this is. This is, I hope I get his name right. I think it's Philip Mason. He's a British scientist. He's a skeptical atheist, and he does a lot of videos, and I've watched them. It's been some time ago, but he is very anti-feminist and uses the expression that feminism poisons everything. Mm-hmm. I would like to say, in the case of Rebecca Watson, she just gave a speech in a foreign country about feminism and how she likes to be treated. So the person in the elevator attended that conference, supposedly listened to her, and then did exactly the opposite of what she wanted. She has had death threats because she wrote a tweet saying, come on guys, don't do it. Richard Dawkins wrote a very hateful tweet saying, well, you don't have, I mean, it's really tough. It was a dear Muslima. And it was, I think you have to be real careful when you tweet something, and I'm sure Richard Dawkins regretted that, and I don't think he's anti-feminist, but that was a very hurtful tweet, and I think hers was very just, hey guys, don't do that when somebody has told you they don't want to be approached that way.
Okay, so my point on this is that this is a good discussion that really has nothing to do with feminism, and it's kind of wrong to bring feminism into it. See, what happens is Rebecca Watson is, you know, says she's a feminist, and here's the thing that happened. So she's mixing it up with feminism, but it's really about what's appropriate. Is it appropriate to invite a woman to your room at 4 a.m. in an elevator in a foreign country? Well, it's Ireland, they speak English and it's a nice place and everything. Is it appropriate? That's a good question. Some people may say yes, some people may say no, but that really has nothing to do with feminism, I think. And so I think this is a case where it's brought up as some kind of feminist issue, and it's not, it's a social issue.
It's an issue for women because Rebecca had just given a talk and specifically said, mm-hmm. as I understand it, I didn't hear the speech, this is how I would not want to be treated. So it's a total lack of respect. And I think women want to be treated with respect. That's a foundation of feminism.
Well, let me tell you a funny thing. I heard somebody else talking about this. They said, what would happen if it was another woman in there? And, you know, it was a lesbian. And she said that. Would that also be a feminist issue? See, it's still sexual. And this one guy said, you know, I went to the bathroom once, and this guy put his hand on my shoulder and said, hey, buddy, you know, you want to do something with me? And even had his male member sticking out. And he goes, no, mate. And he goes, well, you can't say that's sexism. It's just a social awkward thing. You don't do that. And so that's why I'm saying I don't think it has to do with sex or feminism. It's just what's appropriate or not.
And Rebecca Watson, in the video that Thunderfoot's talking about, said something that I totally disapprove of. I would never speak like that. I would never talk like that. So in some ways, when he called her out on it, I can understand that. I think the real issue here is, and I want to applaud Matt Dillahunty, who's an atheist, who is on Twitter, and he was going to an event in Australia, and it was called, it wasn't the Four Horsemen, but it was something with three men, and I can't remember the name of it, I'm sorry. And I said, well, God, why aren't there any women? He says, you know, this was arranged a long time ago. I'm very careful when I'm on a panel to be sure that there's women represented. So I want to give him credit for that. I think that those who have power, who are well known, like the Four Horsemen, Christopher Hitchens has passed away, should encourage and mentor people who are less represented, whether it's minorities, whether it's gender, whether it's race, whatever, and bring those people along so that we have an inclusive movement. I mean, if we really believe, as I do, that religion is not going to move us forward. It's going to harm us. We're not going to be able to deal with climate change or a lot of other issues without rational thought and without giving up an Iron Age deity, then we need to have everyone involved.
Okay. All right. So I guess we're going to open it up for general discussion. So you guys can challenge us or give your own viewpoint or however you, you know, see fit.
Just an aside, I think you mean Bronze Age. When you say Iron Age.
Well, and it certainly continues. I mean, the child sacrifice, et cetera, it predated that.
That was bronze. That was,
yeah.
Because some have iron going up to now.
Okay.
It's
certainly earlier, yes.
I should have said that.
Starting in the Bronze Age. That's fine. I stand corrected.
One question I have, it perplexes me, is why with atheism, which I share, and feminism, I would consider myself a feminist, in a core way, equal and respect. Why is the focus so strongly on Christianity? Why isn't more of it diverted to Islam? With Islam spread, its aggression to spread, and how horribly and how literally and totally Bronze Age it is. And I just don't understand it seems like it would be more effective, or it would be better for women, better for feminism, better for people in general, if more attention was paid to Islam.
I think that's a very valid point. In the book that I have written, it deals with Christianity. There's a woman who's Jewish, and primarily that's because that's what I am comfortable talking about. I am not an expert in Islam. I haven't read the Quran. And I do think that there are people who can speak about that much more knowledgeable than I can. Ayan Hussein-Ali, the infidel, as an example, she wrote. She is an excellent writer. She's talked about the reform of Islam. It's just, I think you can just take on so much and read just so much. And I don't feel comfortable. I think clearly we can address terrorism. Yes, absolutely. But if I were to speak about how to reform Islam, That is not something I would feel qualified to talk about, and I'm in the United States. So I think we have a lot of work to do here dealing with religion in this country, and if we're not willing to examine the religion that's prevalent among us, how are we going to do it elsewhere?
I would say for me too, I mean, I could talk about Islam, but I prefer not to just because I value my life, and I don't want to get killed for it. Seriously, I mean, I don't want some hotheads looking me up and trying to death threaten me. And
that speaks to how much more of an imminent and serious threat it is.
Well, the other thing, though, too, is I think is if, as an atheist, if we can go after Christianity, I think Islam is orders of magnitude sillier and more ridiculous. And so if people can leave...
You're getting death threat.
Hold on, though. But see, if people leave Christianity, I don't think there's any risk that they're going to go into Islam. You know, they're not going to go that way. Frankly, they're too smart for it. Okay, so that's why I'm not really worried about Islam either, for the second reason.
But. Well, and I think there's a biblical voice about taking the stone out of your own eye first. And I think our attitude in dealing with other countries would be better if we examined our own first.
Well, other countries, yes, but I'm talking about a religion where there's, I think it's the WHO, I'm pretty sure I remember this, clear the number, 93 million women are living with the effects of FGM. And wherever it started, that is Islam.
Did you say FGM?
Female genital mutation. It's much more prevalent in Africa. I know Nigeria just passed a law to prohibit it.
In London, and there was the leader of a large mosque in London was demanding that they be given a bye on that law that should not be considered child abuse.
And that's absolutely tragic.
In a Western country.
And I contribute to an organization, a worldwide organization dealing with women, and that's, you know, I feel I can do that financially, and I can help in that way, helping them help themselves and deal with that issue. But obviously, it's much more egregious in those countries and in other faiths than it is here in the United States. There's no doubt about that.
And, you know, I might change my mind, too, if Islam really starts to take a hold here in America. I might change and do that. Because I heard in Detroit they actually have, like, an all-Muslim council, you know, city council and stuff. And, you know, so, I mean, if there's a time where the whole city or something, you know, they're trying to enforce their immoral morality or something like that, it could happen in the future. Okay.
And not to... Not to forget that one of the four horsemen, Sam Harris, is called an Islamophobe for speaking against Islam. And in fact, that's from the left. He's very castigated from the left and the liberals for that. So not only does he have to worry about death threats, but his own people hating him.
And I don't really follow him 100%, so I don't know everything he says, but generally speaking, I'm thankful for what he does. But, you know, he's able to carry a gun with himself, and he has a security detail, and so, you know, he's prepared too, so. Okay.
Well, I'm not sure I'm going to phrase this correctly. Curious, I'm pretty sure I know what Bernie would say, so I would still want to hear what further comments you would have on this as a question for both of you. Is among the mainstream religions, is genuine equality and genuine non-harmfulness possible to women?
I don't think you can do that within Christianity. I went to this Jesus Seminar on the Road program I was mentioning before we started the video, and it was interesting. It was in a church. It was talking about there really isn't a God. And they were talking about how to reform Christianity. Well, if you're going to get rid of God, what's the point? you know, if you're going to go that far and say there wasn't a resurrection, Jesus isn't the Son of God, he wasn't sacrificed, that's really not Christianity. Call it something else. If you like the community and you want to keep getting together, but that's a stretch for me. What's the point? I think we can get a lot farther without religion.
I think when you look at, like, worldwide, all the religions, not by far, but the biggest one is Christianity, followed by Islam. So those are, and, you know, Hinduism, that's going to be, not something I'm really aware of so much, but I'm sure they got a lot of problems. But, you know, in America, too, Well, so the, like the, you know, it seems like the religions are evolving with the times. Like I said, as a Christian, I didn't have a problem with women, and I don't think the Foursquare Church denomination has a problem with women at all. And you know, this largest, they say the largest growing religious segment now is called spiritual but not religious. So basically, because of the culture, people are absorbing the culture, which is, you know, equal rights, you know, gay rights and all that. And so even just in the news now, there's supposed to be some kind of mass walkout on the Mormon church being organized because a lot of, because the Mormon church, I guess, came out with some kind of anti-gay statement. And so now they're trying to plan some kind of mass Mormon walkout or something. So for a lot of people, I mean, just the socialist issues are, they can see the morality of that, and if their church can't do it, they're going to get out. So now you got this whole growing field of people called spiritual but not religious. They're very spiritual. They're very religious. What religion is this, you know? They believe in God, some sort of God out there, but of course they're going to be, you know, they have all society's values as far as equality and all that. So it seems like that's the future. A lot of people are getting into this non-dogma type of religion where it's kind of a deist thing where, of course, there's a God out there, but, of course, all these organized religious tenets are nonsense. So they just want to believe in God without all the dogma and, you know, fully accept equality and things like that.
And if I could just add, I don't think spirituality is a religion. I think it's a transition phase. it's sometimes it's hard to let go of things. And you know, meditation, yoga, those are all good things. But I wouldn't call that a religion. I mean, religion really means to bind people together. Generally, religion has a set of doctrines. So I think it's a transition phase.
And by religion, I kind of meant, according to religious polls, they say, what religion are you? Check this off. You know, you got Baptist, Catholic, spiritual, but, you know, what they call the nuns. You know, the nuns are rising. So none of the above, not Inuans, okay?
Unaffiliated.
Do you guys have any provocative questions for us?
Well, I don't want to take more of my share here, but I'd like to suggest to get your interaction. Christians having a problem with women and all of that, I was a Christian for most of my life, from devout Catholic childhood and through devout fundamentalist Christianity as an adult. But there is a church doctrine that is not biblical of biblical inerrancy, that you have to accept the whole Bible as the revealed, perfect word of God. And that brings along a lot of baggage about women and gays and stuff. And if you just break that, then a lot of Christians, or I would say almost all, with a desire and a heart to get rid of all this. They want to be okay with gay marriage. They want to be okay with total equality, but they're stuck with having to believe and uphold this biblical doctrine. I think if you break that, you could improve Christianity multifold and make it actually possibly even benevolent more than malevolent today.
And I guess I would say in response to that, there's this book that's sitting in the pew in the church, and it's about Jephthah sacrificing his daughter. It's about giving the virgins in battle to the winning side. And if you're going to get rid of the book, I might agree with you. But if you're going to have that book there, it's very misogynistic.
Well, so you can get rid of, you can say, this is not God. This is not to be, this got in there somehow, and we disregard it now.
And women submit to your husband. I think you have to chuck the whole thing.
Yeah, that's, so basically, Pat, what you're saying.
There's not enough baby to worry about it. Just throw it all out.
Throw it all out.
Says the atheist.
Well, it's...
But let me just say, you know, to follow on what you're saying there, Pat, basically that's kind of like the mission that Jennifer Bird does. She has a book called Permission Granted. So she's saying that she would like to, she's got a theology degree, a PhD in theology. And so she's trying to say, when the Bible says, you know, women, obey your husbands, do not talk in church and stuff, just because the Bible says it doesn't mean you, that's directions. It could be just what Paul thought. It doesn't mean that's the way you have to live. So she's trying to, by her book called Permission Granted, she's trying to make a movement where she's trying to say, look, Christians, you can judge these things. You don't have to just take it blindly like that. And so people like her, she's probably a total feminist where women can do anything, and you don't have to interpret it like what you're saying. Yeah, so people like her are trying to do that.
Yeah, and she's certainly not the only one, because I've read some of those, and I don't buy it. That's not how it was ever interpreted. Sure, you could go back and say Milton's Paradise Lost wasn't about hell either. You know, I don't think I want to read it that way. Excuse me, that's how it was written. That's what it was intended to be about. That to me is not appropriate.
There are more churches on the left, per se, that adopt that. You know, basically, the Bible means whatever you want it to mean attitude, then are talked about. There's entire sects, not just individual churches. So the tendency in discussion, it's not just, we talk about, you know, radical Islam, and when we talk about Christianity, we're usually talking about radical fundamentalist Christianity, just don't put those words in front of it.
Well, you know, you know, a weird kind of case is Roman Catholicism, because they're not fundamentalist. You know, they don't think of them as fundamentalistic, but yet they're so...
They're more literalist than the lefter churches and lefter ideas to which I was referring.
I would just like
Brennan. I'm sorry for interrupting you too. So let's let you.
I was just adding that the discussion tends to focus on the what's called the conservative and the fundamentalist, which has experienced a resurgence in the past 10 years or so. It was actually on the downslide. It was more the minority, and it's popped back up in response to social issues that have, you know, as the company or as the country has grown more progressive, there was a backlash where more people went, you know, and went fundamentalist and, you know, rallied against these things that their Bible said was wrong. But you have people on the left who feel very comfortable throwing out sections that they don't agree with, and, you know, standing on the side of these progressive issues and feminism or gay rights or abortion. So, I don't know. I mean, I absolutely understand the idea that, you know, and here's where I had to talk myself through the question. Here it is. is basically, it's kind of what Patrick said about, is there enough baby left to justify? So your position is very clear. It's, you know, if, and I think what you're saying, and clarify for me, if you're saying you have the freedom to read into it wherever the heck you want, then what's the point in having the book anyway?
Yeah, and I don't think I like the metaphor we're using here, but I would like to put this in perspective. Mm-hmm. Every single Republican candidate for president, including the woman, is against legal, safe abortion. Mm-hmm. If women cannot have reproductive rights, to me that's a fundamental core of equal rights for women. Every single candidate, if we go back and reverse Roe v. Wade, it will be a revolution.
Yeah.
Because I can guarantee you the young women in this country will not stand for that. It is fundamental to women's rights to be able to have control over our bodies. And to me it is tragic that we have a complete slate of Republican presidential candidates who say no.
So the question I finally figured out in my head, and I'm sorry for taking so much time talking myself in through it, but it's what value could either of you see, whether maybe it's not at all, in the idea of, you know, here's your religious book, and it means whatever you want. I mean, Bernie, do you see any value in that idea of a very open interpretation of a Bible or a Quran or any religious book?
Well, yeah, I mean, well, as an atheist, I don't see any point in the Bible because I believe that God is an imaginary character, so I can't, you know, mm-hmm. approve any of it. But when I was a Christian, that was, like I said, the way the evolutionary creationists kind of handle it is that's kind of a wave through the Christian church. It's not a denomination, but basically, you know, you accept all science. There's not a conflict with science. You accept everything from the world. There's science and philosophy. There's no problem. If there's a conflict with Scripture, don't worry about it. Put it in the back of your head. Focus on those things that are good, like love, forgiveness, peace, patience, you know, love relationship with God, talking to God in your mind. So, you know, it's just, and it's very mystical too. You know, you feel Jesus in your heart and you pray to God and God talks to you and all this. So, it's possible as a Christian, I did that and I knew a group of people that did that. But one thing I want to say, you know, on the one hand, I mean, you got denominations like the Baptist Church that's very literalistic, and I went to a seminary that was Baptist, so, you know, on the one hand, they teach this, and they believe this, and they want you to believe this, and that's kind of hardcore, and that's what a lot of people think of fundamentalists. But then there's a funny situation is the Catholic Church, where, you know, they'll say, they believe hardcore things too, like birth control is evil. You should not be using the birth control pill. And yet, a Catholic, of course, will use birth control pill. So it's kind of like don't ask, don't tell or something. It's like Catholics do whatever they want to, and it's kind of a weird situation. It's like they don't even know the Catholic teaching because the Catholic Church is even afraid to teach what they believe because they know it's not going to be accepted. So it's kind of like this game you play. You go to church on Sunday, and then you live your life however you want to. It's kind of weird.
Look at how many Catholic politicians are pro-choice and pro-gay marriage and all.
And then sometimes
you don't hear it. Usually, I think it seems like it's the other way. But Nancy Pelosi, the Kennedys.
Yeah. And then sometimes they're called out and threatened, like, "Hey, the Pope should excommunicate this person because look what they're doing." And they're, you know, in their public life, they're advocating for these things.
Are there any other questions?
Has anyone seen the? Well, I was on Yahoo. I think there was a story about there are three of the presidential candidates who went to this.
Oh, yes. I read about that.
The guy was preaching death to homosexuals.
Yes.
They should be killed.
That was very sad.
It's unbelievable that a presidential candidate would attend something mm-hmm. by a person like that. Mm-hmm. Shook hands with him, you know, and introduced him.
I'm not sure. I don't remember specifically who it was, but I did read about it.
Did they sit under that teaching or just under a different message from someone that had taught about it under that teaching?
No, the biblical verse that calls for it.
No, but they listened to him say that and walked out
and
shook his hand.
Oh, yeah, right beside the stage. Well, he was ranting and raving and just... Yeah.
Which candidate was this?
It was Cruz.
Probably Rubio. I don't know.
No, I don't think it was Rubio. I think it was...
Huckabee?
Yeah, Huckabee.
You can look it up. It's all over social media.
There's three of them.
I've seen it several times.
Well-known candidates
that
attended that. I just couldn't believe it.
Thank you very much for coming this evening. We really appreciate it.